Good morning, and welcome to Neely's Creek Church. My name is Matt. I'm the pastor at Neely's Creek Church. By the way, my wingspan is 8.5 feet, so I think that if we, if you come within here, I'll put my mask back on. Otherwise, I can talk a little freer this way. And I would like to welcome you to the worship service here at 11 o'clock. If you are here at 8:30 as well, welcome back. If you would like to do this again, our third service will be online this evening at 6 o'clock, and it will be this service. So you can do your fact checking and then come back and see what you found, or you can see the back of your heads maybe even at 6 o'clock. But we are still in phase one, which means we are together in worship and we are having the three services. So some of us are together corporately and some of us are together virtually. At any rate, it is still the Lord's Day and we are still called to worship. So I will call us to worship momentarily. We have a number of announcements, however. The first one is a video announcement that came to our church and other churches in the ARP, our denomination. So I'd like to have that one go first. I'll bring the rest, and then we will really begin.
Greetings from our witness to Neely's Creek ARP Church. Pastor Matt Joldersma, elders, deacons, moms, dads, kids, everyone, thanks for taking a minute to watch this video, and thank you for allowing your pastor to serve as the board chair of World Witness. I personally greatly appreciate it, like I appreciate your huge heart for missions. As you can see from the picture, we are all finally back at our desks, but practicing social distancing here at the ARP Center. Secondly, our missionaries are almost all on the field, except for just a few who are trapped here because of the pandemic. Many of the missionaries were sick, but all have since gotten better. Like us, they're doing online Zoom Bible studies, live streaming services, children's clubs online. Even one of our missionaries is actually teaching Chechen Muslims French classes via the internet. And like us here in America, they have felt the racial tensions over the last few weeks surrounding the death of George Floyd and are searching for godly biblical responses to all of this. I want to take just a minute to thank you for, one, supporting our missionaries during a time of truly global crisis, and two, to give a short word of encouragement. I have to admit, in the last couple of weeks, I have actually stuck out my hand and offered to shake someone else's hand at least twice. And if you've done that, you are absolutely, of course, not alone. And if you're like me, you shake hands and then you gasp and then you apologize and then you laugh and then you shrug your shoulders. The pandemic has brought a whole new culture that is very unusual and difficult and sometimes funny to deal with. You know, this is culture shock. This is much of what happens when a missionary goes overseas and they experience new social norms. Their system, their emotions are daily, minute by minute, shocked. And some of it's funny, but some of it creates a low level of stress, which comes out in strange ways in how you relate to your spouse or your children or your parents. Sometimes it erupts, sometimes it's just a quiet sadness. And we've all experienced this. And missionaries, as the culture shock begins to wane, they find new ways to find norms and comforts. And they realize that ultimately the cultural comforts that we found in our U.S. culture overseas, when they are not found, they must be found solely in a Christ culture. So our prayer for you today is that you would find daily comfort in the culture and arms of Jesus Christ during this pandemic. And secondly, we want to encourage you that our missionaries are reaching out to a people who are globally in culture shock, but amidst the stress and anxiety have no daily comfort in Jesus Christ. Thank you for being a people who are bringing them comfort. As we read in 2 Corinthians 1, 3, and 4, God has comforted us that we might, with God's comfort, comfort those in affliction. Thank you for being a people of comfort. Thank you for supporting our missionaries.
So the good news is the world hasn't ended. although at times it seems like it might on the next, day. But the mission goes forward of the church, and so it is good to be on that mission together and to have a comfort like no other. If the world was to end this afternoon, the Christians are in large part looking forward to that, actually. But in the meantime, we know our job. We're supposed to make Jesus known. That's the ultimate comfort. So, when the director of World Witness speaks to you on behalf of the missionaries that we are supporting, we are globally together in this for real. And by this, I mean the ongoing mission of presenting the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. A few announcements and a call to worship, I promised. So here it comes. If you are in a Sunday school class that goes by the quarterly curriculum, hopefully you've gotten your copy of that. If not, speak to your teacher and we will figure out a way to get it to you if it hasn't already been done. Hopefully the case is you've got it. There are also daily bread, daily devotionals. Those are available at the exits. If you are one who makes use of those and you don't have one yet, please take one and it is yours to keep. Also, after this service, outside, there's a parent meeting with the youth director, Josh Valentine. After the first service, it was just outside of the Family Life Center in the yard between this building and that one, the one behind me and in front of you. So if you're a parent of youth and you would need to go to that meeting with Josh Valentine, I'm just sending him there, Josh. What? Thanks. Good. I'm glad we have a team. I need that. Good. Social hall over here. Ignore everything I just said, except there's a parent meeting after the service outdoors, but go out there in front of the social hall, which is the next building to my right and your left. Haha. And there's also one of those online tonight at 8:00. So if you miss both or if you really like meetings, you know, we got you covered. Okay. And then from the deacons, these are our instructions to leave the building. Greg will be the last one out. We're going out that door, and you're going to leave from the back of the room to the front of the room. That's how we're going to go out. So if there's any mingling, that happens outside, and then the building can be, sterilized, cleaned, and you will be safe and out. And then there's an offering place on your way out there. I understand. I think that's it. Okay. Let me call us to worship. I'm doing so this morning using Psalm 150. And then we're going to go before the Lord together in song. Psalm 150, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound, praise him with lute and harp, praise him with tambourine and dance, praise him with strings and pipe, praise him with sounding cymbals, praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We have breath. We know then the purpose for which our breath is to be used. Let us sing together this morning. Let us praise the Lord.
Stand with me this morning and sing, O God of our salvation.
O God of our salvation, who reigns upon the throne, the sovereign Father, great is he from whom all blessings flow. Behold the Son, our Savior, who for our sin was slain. Christ who purchased with his blood the wretched souls of men. O God of our salvation, from whom redemption comes. O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one. God the Holy Spirit, revealing deity, the fount of life and love divine throughout eternity. O God of our salvation, from whom redemption comes, O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one. Ascribe unending praises to the God who reigns on high. How matchless is His power, His glory, how divine. Yeah, ascribe, O church, the greatness and the glory to His name. One God, one being, one essence, our triune God proclaimed. Amen. 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 O God of our salvation, from whom redemption comes, O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one.
You may be seated.
Well, to help things keep the germs that we brought in with us, we don't have much to hand out or touch. So I will be taking care of you today along with Chris and Greg. Thank you. This is Chris, by the way, if you haven't met, and this is Greg. And so we are going to enter into a time of prayer after that. We're going to have the scripture reading. That will be from Genesis chapter 31. Then there will be a sermon. The sermon will be followed by another prayer and another song. So that's our order of worship, and it's verbal. And if you have forgotten it, one of the three of us, if not all three of us, will remember it. And you are along for the ride, trusting us and trusting the Lord, who's brought us all together in our various capacities this morning. So, with these things in mind, and together as one in Jesus Christ, let us go before our Heavenly Father this morning in prayer. Pray with me. Oh, Father, this is your day, and you have made it. And we are to rejoice and be glad. And Lord, the world would press that we would not rejoice, that we would not find reason for joy, rather that we would fear. And Father, the fact that we call you Father, that is the proper address for you by your people, in your house, on your day, itself lets us know that apart from you, we really have nothing to fear. And you have seen fit to purchase us by the blood of your Son. Thus, we know that we are exceedingly precious to you. And therefore, so is our gathering precious to you as a witness to the world watching that you do indeed exist. You are the Creator, you are the loving Heavenly Father who has made for Himself a people. Father, we know that Jesus went to the cross to pay the penalty for our sin, Himself being sinless. So today as we gather in His name, far be it from us to excuse sin or to pretend that sin no longer exists, whether externally or even within our own breasts. Father, would you accompany us now by the presence of your Holy Spirit and by the light of your word into our hearts, that we might readily confess to you our sin, that we would be forgiven of them. Father, do now hear our silent prayers of confession. Father, it is evident to us yet again, both from the internal report of our hearts and the external report of this world, that we stand in eternal need of a Savior, and that is a Savior we cannot produce, neither from within nor from without, as far as it depends on we who have been created in your image. We are dependent upon you for the salvation that we are eternally in need of. And, oh, Father, that you would provide it in the person of Jesus Christ, your Son. That you would pay for our sin with his life and then give us his life eternally, credit us with his righteousness. Father, it is an eternal miracle. And we are recipients of what we know to be your grace, for we bring no righteousness to this exchange. Father, we are overjoyed that you would not only point our sin out to us and call it what it is and call us what we are, sinners who are worthy only of death, but then to extend grace and preserve our life eternally. You indeed are great and greatly to be praised. And we do so. We do so in our prayers. We do so as we read your word. We do so as we sing and as we worship together. Father, thank you. Simply, thank you. And thank you that we have eternity to repeat the thank you. It won't be enough. Our thanks is greater. Lord, you have not ended this segment of history. You have not ended the world as we know it. You have upended many things. And so as you have in your word and by your sovereign hand throughout history supplied the world with and even your people with famine and plague and sword, not that we would abjectly fear these things, but that we would be rightly realigned with you. Father, if indeed your church at this time needs a corrective because of the unrest that would produce violence, because of the plague that would be this virus, famine in places of the world where there is famine as well, Father, if it is a corrective, may we be corrective, may we be rightly humbled and, Father, realigned to our purpose on earth as your people, the church. Give us, I pray, the guidance of your Holy Spirit. May we discern his movement and may we understand that it is ours to obediently follow where he leads. So, Father, for the individual Christian, for this church here gathered, 8:30, 11 o'clock, 6 o'clock, called Neely's Creek, for your church universal, I pray that you would, by your Spirit and in accordance with your word, give us words to speak. May our actions be in accordance with your word. May we, by our very lives, with our very breath, exemplify Christ's humility. Would you give us his mind that we would be wise and that we would be unified? Lord, not that only a virus would be confronted and, Lord willing, survived. I don't know. We need you. Or if it is a government that must be realigned with your will and your word, and if the people have a voice within that government, Lord, give us the boldness we need to speak and to have our actions match those words, all of them matching the words you've given us, all of them given in love, all of them given in concern for the other. So, Father, we do need an indwelling of your Spirit, and we are praying even now for revival. We are praying for those hearts that are set against you, that apart from Christ are lost, apart from Christ do not have hope and are hard, and know only malice and anger and fear and division. Father, would you, by your word, by your grace, by the good news, the gospel of Jesus, change hearts, turn hearts away from sin toward yourself, We know that this is your work. We know that the power is yours to do it, but it goes forward when your word is preached, when your word is taught, when your word is spoken. It doesn't return to you void. So, Father, may your church be faithful. May your word go out, and may it return bearing sons and daughters, saved and marked for eternal life. Lord, within this church, there are a good number of needs known to you, as you know even the hairs on our heads. So for those who are expecting procedures in the near future, would you please preserve their health so that these procedures could be underway? For those who are here recovering from recent procedures, for those that are not here because they are recovering from recent procedures, Lord, I pray that you are a present help and that you are a comfort in time of need. Lord, for those who have suffered loss during this time, whether it be loss of income or loss of comfort or loss of security, Father, I pray that you would be the comfort that is necessary and that you would supply that comfort in abundance. Father, for those who have lost loved ones, I pray that you would comfort here also as only you can. And Lord, as we need to go forward through another day, would you equip us with all that we need in order to carry out your will on earth as it is in heaven? We are dependent on you for this as well. So Father, in this time, in this life, would you bless your people and through your people bless this world, that the name of Jesus might be known, acknowledged, and praised forever and ever. It is in his name that we pray. Amen. Okay, we're going to turn now to the reading of God's word. And God's word is inspired and it is infallible. It is eternal. It will stand forever. We're in a sermon series. That sermon series has us in the book of Genesis. This is a sermon series that comes and goes as the years come and go. So we have 2 weeks remaining, including this one, which means next week, Lord willing, will be Genesis chapter 33. Then we'll put a bookmark in it, and Lord willing, 2021, we'll pick up again with Genesis chapter 34, and we'll go forward 11 more chapters and bookmark it once again. So the week after, for those of you who really like to plan ahead, Psalm 25, we generally have, that's another sermon series that's ongoing, and the psalms come one at a time at intervals. So 2 weeks from now, Psalm 25. Then, as we are in any given year, in the Gospels, more than we are in the rest of the Word of God, but only a little bit more than 50%. This year, the time we spend in the Gospels is predominantly spent in the Gospel of John, so we will be there in 3 weeks. Again, Lord willing, and that will be John chapter 1. So, these things being said, let us then turn our attention to the reading of God's holy and inspired and infallible word, Genesis chapter 32, beginning at verse 1. Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's camp." So he called the name of that place Mahanaim. And Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brother, in the land of Seir, the country of Edom, instructing them, "Thus you shall say to my lord Esau, thus says your servant Jacob, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed until now. I have oxen, donkeys, flocks, male servants, and female servants. I have sent to tell my lord in order that I may find favor in your sight." And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, "We came to your brother Esau, and he is coming to meet you. And he is coming, and there are 400 men with him." Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed. He divided the people who were with him and the flocks and herds and camels into two camps, thinking, "If Esau comes to the one camp and attacks it, then the camp that is left will escape." And Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, return to your country and to your kindred, that I may do you good. I am not worthy of the least of all the deeds of steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff I crossed this Jordan, and now I have become two camps. Please, deliver me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, that he may come and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, I will surely do you good, and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. So he stayed there that night. And from what he had with him, he took a present for his brother Esau, 200 female goats and 20 male goats, 200 ewes and 20 rams, 30 milking camels and their calves, 40 cows and 10 bulls, 20 female donkeys and 10 male donkeys. These he handed over to his servants, every drove by itself, and said to his servants, pass on ahead of me, and put a space between drove and drove. He instructed the first, when Esau my brother meets you and asks you, to whom do you belong? Where are you going? And whose are these ahead of you? Then you shall say, they belong to your servant Jacob. They are a present sent to my lord Esau, and moreover, he is behind us. He likewise instructed the second and the third and all who followed the droves. You shall say the same thing to Esau when you find him. And you shall say, moreover, your servant Jacob is behind us. For he thought, I may appease him with the present that goes ahead of me. And afterward I shall see his face. Perhaps he will accept me. So the present passed on ahead of him, and he himself stayed that night in the camp. The same night, he arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream and everything else that he had. And Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket. And Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, let me go, for the day has broken. But Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. Then he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked him, please, tell me your name. But he said, why is it that you ask my name? And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, for I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered. The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the people of Israel do not eat the sinew of the thigh that is on the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip on the sinew of the thigh. Here ends the reading of God's holy and inspired and infallible word, and may it be a blessing to his people. Now, as always, there is much that we come into this time with, whether we are here in person, whether we are online. We come with a significant set, if we're honest, and if we're not, then just allow me to speak for myself, of fears, concerns, worries. All of these, by definition, need to be about the future, because all we can occupy is the present moment. We can look behind us to see what has transpired, to try to guess what might be transpiring in the future. But if we're pressed, we know that we're not able to definitively put down what is going to happen even an hour from now. We don't have that propensity. However, we do have life, and that life seeks to be preserved, usually at all costs. This is God's design. This is natural. This isn't wrong. But when we come together and we are called to worship, we need to understand at least this, that we have been given new life, Why? Because the call to worship is a call issued by God to those whom he has created in his image, and many are deaf to the call. Why? Because they're dead. They're dead in their sin and trespasses. They can't hear the call, and they will reckon with God in the end, period. So for those who can hear the call and respond to it, there is already reason number one to rejoice and be glad in any given day. Now, in this world, the Bible tells us in multiple places, I'm thinking right now of Proverbs, I'm thinking right now of Matthew chapter 5, I'm thinking of the chapters before those, between those, after those, in this life, we will have trouble. Now that can come as a comfort, or that can come as something that induces fear, because we'd really rather not have trouble. We'd really rather be the ostrich and stick our heads in the sand, knowing that when they come up, the trouble will actually be gone. We don't have that right as human beings living in the time after Adam and Eve have sinned. It is declared by God's word. Whether or not we are attuned to God's word, it is evident to us that in this life we will have trouble. So now we have two things that are unavoidable at this point. We have life, and we have trouble, and we have to navigate this. Again, let me remind us that we are called here to worship, and not worship nature, and not worship one another, not worship the collective people who have goodwill toward one another. No, we are here to collectively give praise and honor and glory to our Creator and Sustainer, the Lord God Almighty. And as we're doing this, it is his word that we concern ourselves with. It is evident not only that we have life, but according to his word, where that life has come from. It's come from him. Early in Genesis, we have life because God breathed into Adam. This life that we have is a derivative life. It is from God. It is his to give. He is the source of this life that we treasure and ought to, and that we seek to protect and ought to. And it is this same God who lets us know that the life that we have and treasure is from him, originates in him, who tells us also that we will have trouble. You can see where this could cause us tension, could cause us discomfort. Because if God is good, and he's the giver of life, and he's telling us there's going to be trouble, well then is he really good? Wouldn't he take away the trouble? Or comfort. God is good, and he's given us this life. And we, through Adam, have failed the holy standards for those created in God's image. We've sinned. And thus we bear the calamity of having sinned in such a heinous way. And the penalty for that sin is ultimately death. And God says, in this world you are going to have trouble, but you're also going to have my word. You're also going to have me. I'm still with you. And I am still good. And all hope isn't lost if all hope is placed where it ought to be placed. And that's in me. So essentially, this is God's word, a call to faith. For those who have faith, this is to help us persevere in our faith, come what may. And it is to rightly place our faith in God. And he is so powerful, but so gracious in the way that he interacts with us and deals with us and puts up with us and still determines to show us grace individually, collectively as his church, and to the world, his church, as the conduit for the gospel to go forward. How's that so? Matt, why didn't you talk about what we found in the Bible here today? I am. I promise you I am. So let's look at Jacob and permit me to paraphrase. Again, you can do your fact checking and you can come back later at 6 o'clock and take your notes and write me that encouraging letter. Let's look at Jacob. If what I have said at this point today together is true, then it will be true here. It will apply here. Well, it should, because this is where I got it from. Jacob, if you know Genesis, or if you were here last week, he has trouble behind him. Laban, his uncle, who had taken advantage of him for 20 years and who he needed to flee physically with all of his possessions, there was a confrontation. The Lord intervened and told Laban, you better not speak to Jacob, either good or bad. Essentially, paraphrasing, the Lord said to Jacob's enemy, back off. And Laban wisely did. And so Jacob came through trouble. Jacob came through a problem, only to face another and greater problem. He's following God's lead. He's following God's orders to return to the promised land, and that's where he's going. And he knows that in that promised land is his wronged brother Esau. If you recall chapter 27, we have Esau, who's been cheated by Jacob out of his inheritance, out of his birthright, and he is not happy about it. We have also there in Genesis 27, 20 years before, when Jacob left the promised land, his mother saying, you need to go. Esau's going to kill you. He's comforting himself with the thought of killing you. This is running in his head. This is occupying his real-time thinking. And you know your brother is an accomplished hunter. He knows how to take life. And you know the history, our family history. There's one called Cain and there's one called Abel. And you know that it is entirely possible for brothers to have such animosity, such hatred for one another as to do violence one to the other, even to taking one's life. So Jacob, going back into the promised land, is greatly afraid and distressed. So let me address the people gathered here and the people online. I don't know which camera to look at, so I'm not going to look at any of them, but you're here. What do we do when we find ourselves in a position of trouble? Of a problem. Well, number one, we don't find ourselves surprised, I hope. We really shouldn't. But perhaps we do. Then, like Jacob, do we also find ourselves afraid and greatly distressed? Maybe we do, maybe we don't. If we do, there's biblical precedent that when trouble comes, and particularly that trouble which is threatening to remove life, when that level of trouble comes, there's at least biblical precedent for those who are living under the covenant of God, who have a covenant relationship with him, to be afraid and distressed. So I don't know if I'm talking to anybody in this room who has known some level of fear or some level of distress or some level of fear and distress linked to the potential of losing your life. Whether or not you have or haven't, this is God's word and it stands. So it either addresses you retroactively, you've been there, you know what we're talking about, or proactively, you'll be there at some point because at least you're going to reckon with God one day, face to face. And so it's telling you in advance what to do when you are in that situation that threatens to remove your life from you. Here's my two questions for us, again from chapter 32. Do we plan or do we pray? Are we allowed to plan? Are we allowed to pray? Do these have any relationship one to the other? I want to deal briefly with these so that we can get to this wrestling match. First of all, there is biblical precedent here that when faced with trouble, and we will be faced with trouble, when faced with a problem, and we will be faced with problems, there's biblical precedent here to plan. To use our faculties as quickly and as efficiently as we possibly can. We know this about Jacob so far. He is a good shepherd. Fine. What does that mean? I'll tell you what that means. That means he knows economics. That means that he knows risk assessment. That means that he knows people management. That means that he knows strategy. That means that he knows a lot of things. And you can see it in the plan that he instantly puts in place when he hears that his brother, who has been ruminating on killing him now for 20 years, is coming with 400 men. What conclusion would you draw? Risk assessment. One target is easier to hit than two. Let's make two targets. Whew. Management. You go here, you go here. Now, move. Economics. I might get out with something. I might not lose everything. And he sends them on. Human resources, right? Psychology. Maybe if we mollify with gifts. Maybe if there's a sequence of gifts. This is just good business. And so Jacob is implementing all of these things immediately, but does he rely only on his plan? No. We find him here praying. Instinctively, he plans. There isn't anything in the Bible that says he shouldn't have done that. So don't feel bad if you are a planner or if you think that you need to plan or if you try your very best to plan, especially for problems. It's okay. When and if you start to put your faith in your plan, we got trouble. Because who came up with that plan? Was it just you? Okay, so then your faith is in whom? Well, it's yourself. And now I know I'm talking to you when I say somebody in here might be afraid. Because as soon as you put your faith in yourself, you know that you don't have the goods to come through. And it's only a matter of time before you fail. You'll know it before you fail. Others will know it when you fail. There's a great fear there. So here's prayer. And Jacob prays this way. I'll summarize again. He gives the Lord's words back to the Lord. Here's what you said. You said, go back. I'm going back. Then he gives his position. I am asking for your help. I am afraid. Please protect me. And then he uses the Lord's words back to the Lord again. So he knows God. He knows his word. He knows he's afraid. And so he couches his prayers in the Lord's word, his predicament, and the Lord's word again. So maybe this is something you just put in your pocket this morning. How am I supposed to even pray? Okay, just put this one in your pocket. Why don't you try starting your prayers with the Lord's word? He spoke it, and if you're addressing him in prayer with his own words, he's going to hold to them. He's going to keep them. You're going to be reminded what he said. This is going to be the beginning of comfort. This is going to be the growth area for faith. Then you insert your position, and you don't pretend to be what you're not. Lord, here's your word, and I'm super brave and strong, so I'm looking for you just to hold up a mirror so I can see myself, the brave, strong guy that I am. Here's your word, Lord. I'm coming to you. I'm scared, and I am powerless. I am unworthy, says Jacob, and that represents us well. And then here's your word again. Lord, I can't believe you're still talking to somebody who is as worthless as me. Lord, I can't believe that you would give ear to somebody who is as worthless as me. Yet, here's the prayer that Jacob prays. And thus, if we are then called not only to faith, but to interact with this God at every point in history, in this faith and in prayer, I think this is a good model for prayer. It would make sure that we knew God's word if we're going to use it in our prayer, wouldn't it? It would make sure that we're praying too, wouldn't it? So our facing of trouble can and ought to, I think, include a planning. And it can and ought to certainly include praying. And then we leave it to the Lord to overlap. So here's the next caution I need to give you before we go to the wrestling match. Ready? What we must not ever do is put faith in our prayers. Meaning the way we pray or the how we pray. Certainly we're to be prayers, those who pray. And certainly there are ways to pray more in line with God's word and ways to pray less in line with God's word. My point is this, we mustn't trust in our plan or our provision or our strength at any point. Neither must we have faith in our praying, because that faith then is sickly. I mean, it's twisted, but we'll do it. It's in ourselves still. So the next thing we need to learn from Jacob, and we're going to get a very visceral lesson about this right here. As we're learning about Jacob, we're learning about ourselves. Jacob knows that if any plan is going to work, it's because God wills it. And the best plan, if God doesn't will it, is not going to come to pass. Let me qualify that, fact checkers. The best plan is God's plan. That one's going to come to pass. The best plan of mankind, if the Lord doesn't will it, it will not come to pass. So Jacob recognizes that he is dependent utterly upon the Lord in facing trouble. Laban in the past, Esau in the future. And now we have a really neat way of seeing this. And I hope that we can start to learn a little bit of how we need to act as people in crisis, particularly those of faith. We see in the latter portion of the chapter that as he has sent the gifts ahead, as he has sent his servants ahead with the gifts, he sent his servants with the party line. Say the same thing. Don't let there be any misunderstanding. Repeat it back to me. I don't want you shooting off the cuff. I don't want you making up what you think I maybe mean for you to say. You say these words. Why? I'd like to avoid a fight. I want Esau to know I have plenty. I'm not looking to take from what you've got. You give Esau gifts, meaning I'm not here to fight you for what you've got. I have enough. You can take from me. I'm using language that puts me in place as your servant. All this has taken place. And now again, if I'm regarding the fear and distress, if I am talking to you retroactively, you have known fear and you have known distress. Okay. If I'm talking to you proactively, you are going to know fear, you're going to know distress. Okay. Is it possible I'm talking to you right now and you know a very significant level of fear and distress? Real time, present tense, current. So be it. Psalm 46, the Lord is near and present in time of trouble. As we read his word, as we pray, we know that he is true to his word. Thus, he is near, here, now, to you, O you of little faith, and O you of great fear. And he is addressing you lovingly through his word and with this account today. With trouble facing you, and let's say that you know trouble's facing you tomorrow. Let's even say that tomorrow you know that the level of the problem you're going to face is that which Jacob is facing. You're going to be in danger of your life tomorrow. How's your night going to be spent, do you think? Okay. I want to tell you where the Jabbok is. This is where Jacob, in the night, sends the remainder of his possessions and people across. Sends his two wives, his two female servants, the 11 children, the remainder of his possessions during the night across the Jabbok. And he remains in the camp all alone, the place that he has named Mahanaim, two camps. Why? He saw messengers from the Lord there. Jacob's message was, Jacob is behind us. Jacob is coming. Jacob had met God's messengers. What do you think their message most likely was? Jacob remains in Mahanaim, two camps, all by himself. The Jabbok is in a valley. It flows east to west or west to east. It's situated east-west. It flows into the Jordan River. It is on the east side of the promised land. And so here we have Jacob having trouble behind, trouble in front. He is literally in the valley, and it is dark, and he is afraid. And now he is standing utterly exposed. He has no possessions with him. He has no people with him. If he has a shirt on his back, that is all he has. And then what happens? A presence. Somebody comes. Now, for you, those of you who would know fear, for those of you who would know distress, you know what it's like to be in the valley. You know what it's like to be in the dark. You know what it's like to be afraid. And if you're a praying person, that's when you want God to show up. And in fact, the reader here knows that's exactly who does show up. But I don't think you want him to show up like this. I know I don't want him to show up like this, but God is God. And he's going to do what God is going to do, and it is always going to be according to his will and his purpose. And if you are one whom he has called, if you are one whom he loves, and by being created in his image, he thinks an awful lot of you. I'll tell you that. He's going to address you in the way that you need to be addressed. So how here is Jacob addressed? In the dark, in the valley, on the cusp of a problem that could remove his life from him within the next 24 hours. Well, you and I would love God to come to us in this Psalm 46 way, near and present in time of trouble, right? Right. Well, God comes. He comes very close. We'd love God to come in the Psalm 91 fashion, right? To spread out his wings and cover us with the pinions, with the feathers, to shield us, to protect us, right? Well, he comes, and Jacob senses him, and it's dark, and he can't see the face. He can't make out the identity. He doesn't know who this somebody is, but suddenly this somebody accosts him, spreads out the arms, but then puts a crushing death grip on him, and he realizes in an instant, right now, I am in the fight for my life. And it is just as I expected all along. It's just as I feared all along. It's up to me. It's up to my strength. It's up to my strategy. It's up to whether or not I have the strength to put this one into submission. And he spends the night trying to do this. And we read that as day is breaking, his adversary touches his hip and wrenches it out of socket. Now, for those of you who have known fear and distress, have you ever added excruciating pain? It doesn't seem like the situation is getting better. It doesn't seem like this is any sort of a picture of a loving God, but this is exactly what it is. What is God doing? He is bringing Jacob to the end of himself. As a matter of fact, when the new day dawns, his name will no longer be Jacob. This is the end of Jacob. This is it. And who is he wrestling? He's wrestling the God who has made the covenant, made the promises, is yet going to make another one, who's going to change his name, who clearly has the upper hand. If Jacob has been wrestling all night and not been able to prevail against this one, and suddenly this one touches his hip and dislocates it, what does Jacob do at this point? He holds on tight. He doesn't quit. He doesn't give up. He doesn't roll over. He doesn't play dead. You know what he does then? That's when he demands the blessing. His adversary says, "Let me go. Day is breaking." We know that that's God. We also know from God's word that if you see his face, you die. Jacob most likely knows that if this one can touch my hip and wrench it out of socket, I'm dealing with no human. I'm dealing with the divine right here. And he knows that if he sees the divine's face, he's going to die. And he holds on as tight as he can. And he says, "I know this might kill me, but I am not letting go until you bless me." He shows great tenacity. And his desire is for the blessing of God, if God is willing to give the blessing. But if God isn't willing to give the blessing, then it is God and God himself who will end his life. And that will be satisfying. May it fall to no other to take that right and that privilege and carry it out. And so the adversary asks Jacob his name, and he has to admit his name. "My name is Jacob," which means grasper, heel grabber, swindler, thief. That's who I am, and I am demanding a blessing. And does God smite him? No. Does God allow Jacob to put God into submission? No. Will God ever let anyone created in his image, or everyone altogether created in his image, to put him into submission? No. But did God take Jacob's life? No. He gives him a new name, Israel. And this is a little soupy. It can mean strives with God. And it can mean God strives. God fights. So what have we learned here? And what can we take home? And how can we live tomorrow? We have a certain level of responsibility. We have a certain level of planning, of prioritization, of power. We are still utterly dependent upon God. And so when God says, "Your name is Israel," that means this: you struggled with God face to face, and you weren't ended. You weren't decimated. I had the power to end you at a touch, knows God. And I refrained from doing so, even though your name is Jacob. Even though you are a swindler and thief, even though you stole from my tree in the Garden of Eden, seeking to be autonomous, to live separately from me, to put me into submission, it will never happen. And I have the power to harm you. But I am changing your name. I am calling you my own. And you are going to know from this point forward that you are dependent upon me for every blessing now and forever. You are dependent on me for every breath. And my desire is to bless you now. As we close, and as we've been instructed that we're going to have trouble, and as we've been instructed in how to pray in that trouble, and hopefully how we've been instructed that our dependence is wholly on the holy, holy, holy God to prove himself and to show himself, and that can be in pushing us down into the dirt from which we've come, only to then preserve our life so we know our place. That's loving, that's kind, and is awfully generous. Jacob receives a new name. It is now Israel. He names that place of the struggle, which we could get to today. It's on a geographic map. We could find the Jabbok. He names it Peniel, the face of God. I've seen the face of God and I've been spared. Thus, I can go forward knowing that I am under his protection. I can face my brother who wants to kill me, because he and I both are under the Lord's jurisdiction, and he will do as he pleases. And in this case, his desire is to bless. Now, why all this? Why all this? So we can have a present hope? Certainly. So we can have hope for tomorrow? Certainly. Well, can I go so far as to say eternally? Certainly. Quick family tree, quick history. Adam and Eve. Eventually then, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Abraham had his name changed. By who? The one who had authority to change it. God. Sarah had her name changed. By who? God. The one who had authority to change it. Isaac was named before he was born. By whom? God. Jacob had his name changed. By whom? God. The one who had authority to change it. Why is God working this way in these people's lives who at times are only reprehensible? It's so that his will is clearly superimposed upon man's will, and yet he goes with them and even goes for them to bless them. We run that family tree down, and eventually there is another combatant that comes from the line of Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, which means, remember, strives with God, but also God strives. There is one that comes from the family tree of Adam through Jacob, whose name is Jesus. Jesus is of the tribe of Israel. God strives. Jesus' name means God is salvation, or God provides salvation. So here is another one who must go into the night, and who must go into the night in prayer, and who must submit to the will of God as God. Why? Because he's also Israel. He is the God who strives for his people, that they might behold him face to face and know no fear. This is a divine initiative. This is a divine outworking. This is the history that we are a part of now, and to which he is faithful, both history and his people within that history. So regarding this face of the adversary that Jacob was up against, and who he recognized, whether visually or simply by the character of the one who could dislocate his hip at a touch, the one, after having encountered him, caused Jacob to name the place Face of God. By the way, when Jacob asked him his name and he said, "Why do you ask me my name?" That's as if to say, "Really? You know who I am. And you're walking away from this. Remember that. This is grace." Okay, so keeping in mind then that face that Jacob may or may not have seen as the face of God, and knowing that it is God's design to strive for his people, and I mean that for his people, to reclaim his people, to gain his people back again for himself, to reestablish the face-to-face relationship that existed in the Garden of Eden before the fall. Who is this one, Jesus, God saves, who is also Israel, God strives? Well, he's speaking to his disciples before his crucifixion, on the evening, as a matter of fact, before his crucifixion. The evening before the day of his greatest trouble, he's speaking to his disciples. And so in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, these few verses, starting at verse 8, Philip, this is one of his disciples, Philip said to him, this is Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Philip and the others, and many, many others, have had the privilege of seeing the face of Jesus. And Jesus just said to Philip and anyone else who would ever hear his word again, if you've seen my face, you've seen the face of the Father. God with us. God strives for us. He goes to the cross. Jacob walks away with a new name and a limp. He was spared his life, but he was blessed. Jesus comes away with holes in his hands and holes in his feet and holes in his side and his brow, scraped and scratched and cut and bruised. That's a fighter. And he is God. And he has fought for his people. And he was placed in the tomb, and there's some eternal darkness for you unless you're Jesus, unless you are without sin and have been wrongly condemned, unless God the Father Almighty overturns the sentence and you receive your life back again and you are raised from the dead victorious on that day, which is then a new day and a new era. And so 8 days later, and this is John chapter 20, Jesus' disciples were inside again, and Thomas, another disciple, was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen yet have believed. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. When you have life in Jesus' name, that means in his name. You've been baptized into his name. You belong to him. You're his. He is the one who has fought for you. He is the one who has prevailed. So, believer, if at any point you would know distress or great fear, know this, you belong to him who has overcome death, who has overcome the world, who has gone to prepare a place for you, and who will return to bring you into it. Thus, you have no fear if your faith is rightly placed in this one. When we misplace our faith, fear is the quick companion. And so for those who know fear, not of Jesus, but apart from Jesus, then may I put forward to you the gospel, the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. When your fear is rightly of him as the coming King and Judge, and when you respond to the gospel by his grace and in faith, and he indeed becomes your Lord and your Savior, then guess what? You are saved, and you also have a Lord. You are no longer autonomous, but neither do you have anything else to fear. Ever again, in this world, on Judgment Day, or in the world to come. Now, if that can't get you through a Monday morning, I promise you there is nothing that can. So it is up to the Lord, by the power of his Spirit, to change the hearts of those whom he will change, to call to himself those whom he will then keep. And we leave that to his prerogative, but this is his word, and may it be a blessing to his people now and forevermore. Pray with me. Lord, we are reminded again, very colorfully and unmistakably, of our need for you and for salvation. We are reminded again of our unworthiness. Yet you would pursue us, yet you would press us even to within an inch of our lives in order to acknowledge you as Lord, and then to find, lo and behold, you are determined to save. Father, may we know joy unspeakable. May we then rejoice and be glad. And Father, as we would then stick out like sore thumbs in this world that does not see anything to rejoice about nor anything to be glad about, may we be quick to put forward the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the true Israel, who has fought for his people and won. Father, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us close our time together here in song once again. Let's sing. Receive then the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be merciful unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. The first shall be last. So in the back of the room, out you go.